Well, good morning, everybody. It is so good to be able to gather together and worship with you, even if it is a little separated. We're so thankful to have the technology to be able to join together and worship on this wonderful Sabbath day. To get things started off this morning, my son Caleb Workman is going to be playing Amazing Grace.
Good morning, happy Sabbath, everybody, for our scripture reading this morning. Let's turn to Luke chapter 6, verses 20 through 23. And it says, "And he lifted up his eyes on his disciples and said, 'Blessed be ye poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are ye that hunger now, for you shall be filled. Blessed are you that weep now, for you shall laugh. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you, and when they shall separate you from their company, and shall reproach you, and cast you out, and cast your name out as evil, for the Son of Man's sake. Rejoice ye in that day, and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven. For in the like manner did their fathers unto their prophets." Amen.
Okay, thank you so much, Sandy, for reading that. So that was my wife, Sandy. I'm sure most of you, many of you know. And that was my son, Caleb. My name is Isaac Workman. I have had the privilege of serving for a little bit as head deacon here at Hillsboro. And we have somewhat recently moved from Alaska. It was about 10 months ago now, I guess, that we moved down. And so we loved the winter. It was amazing. And it was kind of like the summers in Alaska. And then the summer came. And we've been adjusting. But it has been a blessing to get to know a lot of the brethren here in this area. Today's message is called Stepping Stones to the Throne, God's Purpose for Your Hard Times. What is God's purpose for hard times? Just to open, let us pray together. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the opportunity again to come together and to look at your word and to look at the big picture and to see your hand and how it is that you are working. We pray that you would be with us here today through the agency of your Holy Spirit, that we would hear and realize, Lord, the things that you have for us today. Amen. So on this earth, we will have trials. And that reality has only been intensified and exacerbated with the arrival of COVID-19. Everything is COVID-19, isn't it? Anytime I turn on the news, it's COVID-19. I think now and then, maybe once or twice a week, you hear something that's not. But COVID-19 has definitely changed the tenor of things in this earth, and it's caused a lot of trial. There's a whole new realm of hardships. Many have lost jobs, many have been sick, and much of our interactive freedoms are gone. Schools are different than ever before. Children are not able to attend their usual schools, and it feels sometimes as if we're just supposed to hibernate or disappear. Many parents have children at home, and were hoping that things would open back up in time for fall of 2020. Often a social setting with boundaries and a variety of teaching styles can be so helpful to our hyper-intelligent or highly active kids. But now, it's one-on-one and 24/7, kind of like an extended summer indefinitely. So what's really happening in our world? Everything is changing so fast, and it's causing many to a growing sense of apprehension and even fear. This global and personal hardship raises the question, how can a loving God let trials come up, come upon his faithful followers? How can a loving, caring creator have a plan and purpose for pain? Why do bad things happen to good people? You ever wondered that? I think probably we've all grappled with that. How is it that bad things can happen to good people, especially God's faithful people who are seeking him? Trials and hardship will never be easy. If they were easy, it would not be a trial. By definition, a trial is hard, difficult, and painful. A trial is an intensifier. They cause movement. As things heat up, we can either hold on to God and grow stronger, or if we let go, we will fall away. There is no constant or static experience in this life. Because trials on this earth are an unavoidable reality, it's essential to understand God's plan and purpose for trials. Because if I don't understand his purpose, he will seem cruel and heartless, not someone that I can trust with my life. So, what is God's great purpose for the trials in our lives? 2 Corinthians 12:7 says, "And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, or three times, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, Paul says, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake." Wow. Continues, "For when I am weak, then I am strong." To glory in infirmities, to take pleasure in infirmities. That is amazing. So, why was Paul taking pleasure and glory? It's because he had finally learned the purpose. What was it? What was the purpose that he described? He said, "My strength is made perfect in weakness." He said, "It was a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure." So Paul was an amazing orator and lawyer, but God allowed this trial to keep him humble. And why was it important for him to be humble? It was so that he can have a more powerful experience. So this is one reason the Bible gives for God allowing trials. They help us to stay humble, and thus they are beneficial for us and for God. But there's another aspect that ties into this. Let's look at a brief biography. It's a story about a young man whose relationships were not easy and who faced one extreme injustice after the next. But he was faithful through it all, and ultimately, he was promoted to prince over the entire realm. In this little biography here, we're going to see that trials don't just help us have a good experience in the moment, but also prepare us for more responsibility and blessing in the future. Those two things. So these trials we can call stepping stones. Just for fun, see if you can count how many horrible things happened to this young man, and notice how God uses every one of these events as an amazing providential stepping stone to the next phase of even greater responsibility and blessing. You guys might know who I'm talking about. Joseph was born in Mesopotamia, town of Haran, to his parents Jacob and Rachel. At the age of six, he left Haran along with his family and journeyed to the land of Canaan, eventually settling in Hebron. Joseph had 11 brothers, and 10 of them really had a hard time with him. His father had made the mistake of showing favoritism, not wise, and eventually Joseph's brothers sold him into slavery. Most of you know the story, but if it's not familiar, you can read about it in Genesis chapter 39 through 48. But today, we're just going to have a summary. So as the story goes, Potiphar, after he was sold in slavery and made that trip to Egypt, Potiphar, one of Pharaoh's officers, ends up buying Joseph and becomes Joseph's new master. We can be sure that Joseph was very sad at being separated from his father without even being able to say goodbye, and with no opportunity to send even a message to him to let him know that he was still alive. Can you imagine? This young man had just been sold to complete strangers, then sold again, but Joseph did not waste time feeling sorry for himself. He remembered that God was with him. And this gave him hope and courage to do new duties directly in front of him in Potiphar's house. In fact, we are told that he did his work so well, so faithfully, that Potiphar made him overseer over all his house, and that Potiphar put everything into Joseph's hand that he had, Genesis 39:4. Now, at this point, it might have seemed to Joseph that he was on his way to bigger and better things, but Joseph had an enemy, and Satan was working very hard to try to hinder the plans that God had with Joseph. His enemy was his master's own wife. She told lies about Joseph, which made Potiphar so angry that he put him into prison. When the king's prisoners, where the king's prisoners were placed. For a while, things were looking pretty good with Potiphar, but now, from one moment to the next, Joseph finds himself wrongfully accused and thrown in prison. This was another tremendous trial for Joseph. King David later wrote about the incident in the book of Psalms, saying, "His feet, they hurt with fetters. He was laid in irons." But Joseph remembered that God was with him. So again, instead of being all wrapped up in the circumstances, he looked around for something to do. And he did that thing with all his might. Soon, the warden put Joseph in charge of the entire prison. That's a pretty amazing story. That's pretty amazing. Wherever Joseph went, it was soon that he was sort of manager of that entire space. The warden trusted him just as Potiphar had done. Joseph ended up being in charge of all the prisoners, and among them were the chief butler and chief baker, Pharaoh's household. Of Pharaoh's household. When Joseph went into their cell one morning, he noticed that both of these men looked very unhappy. Joseph's reliance on God through all of his hard trials caused him to be an understanding person, and so he asked why they looked so sad. They told him, "We have dreamed a dream, but there is no interpreter of it." And Joseph asked, "Do not interpretations belong to God?" And then he asked them to share their dreams. Again, you can read about these dreams in the 40th chapter. God blessed Joseph's mind, and he was able to correctly interpret both dreams. The chief butler was to be restored to the king's favor and to his place as cupbearer, but the baker was to be hanged. At this time, Joseph took the opportunity and asked the butler to remember him when he was restored to his position and to speak to Pharaoh about him so that he might be brought up out of the prison. But when the dreams were fulfilled, the chief butler did not remember Joseph. Joseph was completely forgotten. At this point, Joseph is facing more serious discouragement. Days, weeks, and months go by, and he is still there, all on a false accusation. But God is still in control. God knows what he is doing. God sees the end from the beginning, and God has a plan. After a full 2 years go by, Pharaoh had two strange dreams, which greatly troubled him. But none of the magicians or wise men of Egypt could tell the king the meaning of his dreams. Then the chief butler finally remembered Joseph, and Joseph was quickly summoned out of the prison to interpret Pharaoh's dreams. He told the king that it was God who had sent these dreams to warn about a time of famine coming over the whole world. There would be 7 years of plenty followed by 7 years of famine. Joseph advised Pharaoh to prepare by storing grain during the first 7 years. Impressed by Joseph's wisdom, Pharaoh appointed him with the great task. After all, God had given him wisdom to interpret the dreams and offer such good advice. So he made Joseph the chief ruler of Egypt. The Bible says, "And he made him to ride in the second chariot that he had, and they cried before him, bow the knee." So, God had a plan for Joseph. All of his hard experiences, all of the trials that Joseph went through. You know, I've gone through a lot of difficult things in my life, but I can't say any of the main trials that punctuated Joseph's life, I can't say I've been through anything quite that serious. Being sold into slavery, being betrayed and left in prison for years on a false accusation. Wow. But all of these experiences, the betrayal of his brother, the lies of Potiphar's wife, being thrown in prison for a false accusation, forgotten by the butler for 2 years, these were all stepping stones to the throne. To be made the governor of Egypt. Wow. He was second only to Pharaoh. Romans chapter 8, 28 tells us that all things work together for good to those who love the Lord. You see, all the trials, betrayal, and injustice that Joseph faced faithfully were working together to prepare him for a very high position of responsibility and authority. God is doing the exact same thing for you. Luke chapter 6, verse 20, we'll read it again. "And he lifted up his eyes," this is Jesus speaking, "and he lifted up his eyes on his disciples and said, blessed be ye poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are ye that hunger now, for ye shall be filled. Blessed are ye that weep now, for ye shall laugh. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you and when they shall separate you from their company, and shall reproach you, and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. Rejoice in that day, and leap for joy. Behold, your reward is great in heaven. What did it say? It said that when all of these things that really kind of describe what gives us the hardest trials in this life, when this happens, it says, it's very expressive here, it says, rejoice in that day and leap for joy. That is an like maximum expression of joy, right? Leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven. All of these trials are kind of like the stepping stones as we go through them faithfully. That is God's intention. And it is his intention that they would prepare us for heaven. Great is your reward in heaven, for in like manner did their fathers under the prophets. Revelation 3:21 says, to him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame. What are they overcoming? Revelation 3:21, to him that overcometh. What are they overcoming? Of course, they're overcoming personal trials in their lives, character things that are not as they should be, as God is revealing them. All of these things, hard times that are bringing up more issues that we need to work on, right? To him that overcome will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am sat down with my Father in his throne. 2 Timothy 2:12 also says, if we suffer, we shall also reign with him. I hope we're starting to get an idea of God's purpose for the trials in our lives. There's a bigger picture, right, than just what we sometimes see right in front of us. And God is always good. So what's God's purpose for the trials and injustices? And we'll try to summarize kind of briefly. Firstly, they help us keep humble and dependent on him. That's what Paul mentioned earlier. Secondly, they prepare us for more responsibility and blessing in the future. I once heard the story of a little boy who was leading his sister up a steep mountain path. Finally, the little girl said, why, this isn't a path at all. It's too rocky and bumpy. To this, her brother replied, sis, the bumps are what you climb on. Apparently, he discovered how to get a little bit more traction as he was climbing. In other words, according to Jesus in Revelation 3:21, trials are stepping stones to the throne. He says, if we overcome these trials, we will sit with God the Father and Jesus Christ on the throne. Wow. Can you think of anything more amazing than that? Can you think of anything more amazing than sitting with God the Father and Jesus Christ on the throne? Because we can't even begin to imagine what that means. Let's look quickly over at Isaiah chapter 14 and verse 12. It says, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, thou which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit. What did he say that he wanted to do? He says, I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. In heaven, Lucifer started to envy Jesus' position. He wanted to sit on the throne. Now, amazingly, through the process of redemption, Jesus Christ, God of the universe, became a man to endure all the trials of humanity. And thus, amazingly, if we receive him and hold on over all of the stepping stones and trials, we will sit with him on the throne. A new creation, a new species. The reason why Lucifer was not permitted to sit on the throne is because he was a created being, and it was only the eternal God who was able to sit on the throne. But through redemption, through God becoming man, therefore, that is where God is wanting to take us. That is beyond what I think we can fully comprehend. But hallelujah, it is very, very amazing news. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Christ Jesus. Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you, in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Hallelujah. That describes the process there of becoming that new creature in Christ. Hallelujah. God has a plan for your life. Every experience that each day brings simply prepares you for this great plan and brings you to the place that he has appointed for you. His plan is beyond what our human words can even describe. God never leads his children. This quote is Desire of Ages, page 224, paragraph 5. God never leads his children otherwise than they would choose to be led if they could see the end from the beginning and discern the glory. Have you ever heard that promise? That's important to remember. As we are going through trials and wondering, man, God, what are you doing now? It's important to remember that God never leads us otherwise than we would choose if we could see the end from the beginning and discern the glory of it, of the purpose that God is fulfilling with us as co-workers with him. She goes on to say, not Enoch, who was translated to heaven, not Elijah, who ascended in a chariot of fire, was greater or more honored than John the Baptist, who perished alone in the dungeon. Unto you it is given in behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. Philippians chapter 1:29, and all the gifts that heaven can bestow upon men, fellowship with Christ in his sufferings, I'm going to read that part again, and of all the gifts that heaven can bestow upon men, fellowship with Christ in his sufferings is the most weighty trust and the highest honor. So we're talking about how God has taken us to the throne. We're talking about the amazing things that God does. We're talking about how God used all the different trials and hardships in Joseph's life to take him even to the earthly throne there of the Empire of Egypt at that time. And often when we think about these, you know, glorious things that God is able to do, and these amazing blessings, we can lose a little bit of the concept of really what the most amazing thing really is. This is sort of a paradigm shift, I think, for us to realize. Because it says, of all the gifts that heaven can bestow upon men, fellowship with Christ in his sufferings is the most weighty trust and the highest honor. So you can start to see a little bit more why Luke wrote that we should jump for joy, and why Paul was saying that he's going to glory in the trials. because now Ellen White is sharing that the fellowship with Christ in his, and in his sufferings is the most weighty trust and the highest honor. God is good, you see. God is good always. It's easy. Anytime we find ourselves really falling off the path, it's because we've actually forgotten that point. It's the most fundamental point in Christian concepts, right? But anytime we start falling off the path is because we've forgotten that God is good. But God is good always. He's working everything out for us, not just allowing things to happen to us, but he is causing things to happen for us. He's bigger than our problems. And if we could see the future and understand, we would not change one thing in the path that he's marked out. That is amazing. Even if we were to go all the way back to the beginning, looking at this point, Adam and Eve, they had to leave the garden, right? It's not just because God was mad at them and he wanted to punish them, and so you need to, you know, suffer, right? You need to dig some weeds and toil and work and sweat and be hot, right? It wasn't just punishing them, but he was leading them on the path of salvation. He was saving them. They couldn't, if they could have been saved in the garden, he would have left them there. He would have been happy to have them in the garden in all of its paradise, but that was not going to be saving for them. And so he led them out of the garden so they could see the cause and effect of their actions, and so that they could learn, and so they could have another opportunity at salvation. 1 Corinthians 2:9 says, "Eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him." God has an amazing plan through Christ. And over the stepping stones, I believe that each of us gathered here today are going to be able to see it happen. Let's close with prayer. Amen. Father in heaven, thank you so much, Lord, for this reminder today of the incredible privilege that it is to be able to suffer for your sake. This is a just kind of strange for our natural minds to really get around. Suffering is such a privilege that Luke says that he was jumping for joy. That's amazing. But we thank you for showing us the big picture and your plan for the different hard things that we are facing right now, even to take us to the throne and co-rule with us, Lord, throughout eternity. We thank you, Lord, for this, and we thank you for your love and provision for us in our individual places, that we would remember that you are good at every point of trial. We pray these things, Lord. Amen.
There is no problem too big God cannot solve it. There is no mountain too tall He cannot move it. There is no storm too dark God cannot calm. There is no sorrow too deep, He cannot soothe it. If He carried the weight of the world upon His shoulders, I know, my brother, that He will carry you. If He carried upon His shoulders, I know, my sister, that He will carry you. He said, come unto me, all who are weary, and I will give you rest. There is no problem too big that God cannot solve it. There is no mountain too tall, He cannot move it. There is no storm too dark, God cannot calm it. There is no sorrow too deep, He cannot soothe it. If He carried the weight of the world upon His shoulders, I know, my brother, that He will carry you. If He carried the weight of the world upon His shoulders,